Hello, and thank you for listening to our Women at BCG podcast. My name is Frances Brooks Taplett, and I'm a partner in BCG's Boston office and co-leader of our global diversity and inclusion topic. Aerospace and defense is a huge industry. In the U.S., it is a critical part of the U.S. economy in terms of employment and contribution to GDP. The industry represents 2.4 million jobs, $865 billion in sales, and $143 billion in exports as of 2017. And these numbers are likely to keep growing, given that the industry is enjoying a period of unprecedented expansion. Today, I'm here with Lacey Ketzner, a managing director and partner in the Philadelphia office, to talk about the challenges the industry is facing within this growth. Lacey is the lead for our digital in aerospace and defense and co-author of our recent paper, How Women Can Help Close the Talent Gap in Aerospace and Defense. Thank you for joining me here today.
Thank you for having me.
What made you interested in conducting this research?
Good question. So two reasons, really. One is we surveyed employees globally across industries and in industrial good companies in particular, including aerospace and defense, to really understand how diversity and inclusion was being implemented and what specific interventions we could do. The findings, I thought, were very compelling, and they matched what I was seeing in the A&D industry. So wanted to dig in a bit further in terms of research and surfacing what was actually underlying there. And at the same time, being a woman in the industry, many of my clients have mentioned the need and the challenge for diversity in the workplace. So wanted to draw out more of a data-backed answer that looked beyond kind of the normal tropes around what women want and how do you drive inclusion in the workplace, to have something that was more fact-based and drew upon this depth of research.
Fantastic. Well, before we dive into the findings of the paper, maybe we can take a step back and really simply, can you give our listeners a quick recap of exactly what aerospace and defense is?
Sure. So aerospace and defense covers everything that flies, basically. So airplanes, unmanned vehicles, to things that are in space, satellites, spaceships, to, on the defense side, things like large ships, ground vehicles, and other defense-specific crafts. It's big companies like Boeing and Lockheed Martin and SpaceX and Blue Horizon that really found the aerospace and defense industry, but it's thousands of smaller tier one, tier twos as well, as a number of startups that have been coming up that have been, you know, looking at mini satellites, unmanned vehicles, robots. So it's a bit of an eclectic mix, but generally things that fly or things that fly in space is a good rule of thumb for what it encompasses.
Very helpful. So what's happening in A&D right now?
So the industry as a whole is growing quite quickly. Its projected growth is enviable, but as it's been growing so quickly, a lot of that driven by a super cycle on the commercial side, by unprecedented levels of defense spending, there's a limiting factor in terms of how much talent there is out there. And a big issue with this is that the workforce is aging. Types of roles that they need filled now are different than the ones they needed in the past. And just globally, and in particular in the U.S., that there's a significant labor shortage. So you see a huge gap between supply and demand for aviation mechanics, for pilots, for a lot of the engineering resources, not to mention the new digital skills that are going to be pretty foundational for aerospace and defense moving forward. And so as they think about this growth and as they think about continuing the trajectory they're on, the industry as a whole is starting to realize that they're going to need to do a bit of a reset in terms of what they're looking at and how they're filling that talent gap. And in particular, looking at recruiting and retaining women who have historically been underrepresented in A&D could be one solution to this challenge. And that's where we really dug into in this research.
Great. And it would have additional positive impacts as well. For instance, we know from our research that companies that are more diverse, especially at the senior level, are more innovative. So what's the current representation of women in A&D? You said it was low, but can you share a bit more?
It's actually a little bit interesting. Aerospace and defense, compared to other industries, is relatively ahead when it comes to women in top leadership positions. So many of the biggest and best known OEMs are led by women. So I mentioned Lockheed Martin, Raytheon, Boeing has a major business unit led by a woman. And overall, about a quarter of the executive level positions are held by women, which is a higher share than many industries. And if you look at something like the tech industry, where it's also very engineering focused, it's a step change ahead of them. But that being said, in the total workforce, it's actually only around 22%, which is a little lower. It's only 15% of the actual engineers are women as well. So it's not only a shortfall overall, it's a shortfall in some of the key roles. And a little bit of that is a reflection of the engineering graduates. Basically, they are underrepresented from a woman perspective, but it creates kind of both the need and the challenge that's unique to aerospace and defense.
Interesting. It's really fascinating to me that women are better represented in leadership than we see in so many other industries. I wouldn't have guessed that. But it also seems like a really tough market for talent. Can you tell us about the recent research and what the findings were?
Sure. So as I mentioned, as part of this research, we surveyed employees globally across industries and in industrial goods in particular. And we were looking at basically the status of diversity and inclusion today. When we were looking at this, what we found is that there is a higher percentage of women in IG companies that industrial goods, including aerospace and defense, that felt that recruiting was a key obstacle. That's actually about half of the women in IG companies versus more like 38% in other industries. And in the same way, we saw almost half of the women in industrial good companies citing retention as a problem versus closer to about 40% overall. So not only is there basically a bigger challenge here from the recruiting as well as the retention side, most critically or perhaps most notably, we also heard from women that, again, about almost 50% of representatives saying that they had personally experienced discrimination in the workplace, compared with closer to 28% in other industries. So what we're seeing is that not only is aerospace and defense facing a tough labor market from the perspective of the source of their labor tends to skew more male, from the perspective that they're competing for more talent, that they need to fill more talent holes, they're also finding that on a higher percentage basis, many of the women are facing a challenge both getting recruited and staying within the industry and facing this level of discrimination. So it's a tough but not insurmountable challenge that lays ahead as companies think about how do they fill this talent gap and keep the growth going forward.
Really interesting and also a bit alarming. And it shows that many companies are perhaps choosing interventions based on what they think will work rather than identifying those that really do work, given the data you shared. So what can companies do?
That's a great question. I think you're right in your sniff test there that many companies might be choosing to do something that sounds right, but isn't necessarily having the impact that they would need. And so the way we've thought about these is basically looking at the table stakes measures that they need to take, every company, in order to take a better stand against recruiting and retaining women here. And we would say that these are measured as things that both men and women agree are very effective and essential parts of any diversity initiative. And mm-hmm. So like I said, they should just be no-brainers, so to speak, in terms of actions to have in place. I'll name three that really jumped off in terms of our research. The first were structural interventions. So this is just thinking about making the workplace more accommodating to pregnant women, whether it's establishing dedicated working space or whatever, but it's more physical changes that you can take to have a more inclusive workspace. The second one, which I think aerospace and defense is actually well poised for, is visible role models. So like we were saying before, there's actually a number of senior women in aerospace and defense, and having them really talk about their career challenges and how they are changing the industry is very valuable and is reported against as being quite impactful and is not, as we per the other one, necessarily a huge high bar to clear in order to implement. The third is particularly important given that we were just talking about many feel personally discriminated in the workplace. And the third one here is guaranteeing a bias-free day-to-day experience. So often there's not outright cases of discrimination, but there's a need to really understand how there's more subtle discrimination going on that we can systematically root out and kind of steer clear of in terms of office culture. Maybe it's team events that are in some way discriminatory against a certain group. It's mostly those small things and a set of trainings that go along with it that help folks get to this kind of bias-free day-to-day experience.
Really interesting, and thanks for sharing those three. They are consistent across industries, but also seem to be very specific to aerospace and defense. So as aerospace and defense companies are male-dominated, especially for the last intervention you talked about with the bias-free day-to-day experience, teams need to be aware of the self-selection bias in situations in which that's likely to occur. What were the other interventions you identified?
Sure. So these were ones that are typically undervalued, but are ones that women consider particularly effective. So the last three were table stakes. These three are more what we would call hidden gems. And again, some of them bubble up to the top as not necessarily expensive or I would say terribly difficult to implement, and are ones that perhaps aerospace and defense companies can consider on their short list as things that perhaps they haven't thought about before, but will have a huge impact. So just to name a few of these hidden gems, the first are basic anti-discrimination policies. So many have them, but really what needs to be in place is make sure these are sound, make sure they're actually read, make sure that they're dealing with discrimination as it's existing today, and that a communication of these policies can actually be a chance to distinguish the company from other competitors, as well as just create clarity in the workplace and commitment behind a culture of inclusion. The second is just participation in external events. So promoting gender diversity in external events and participating in rankings that look at your diversity in the workplace. This doesn't have as big of an impact per se on the woman's day-to-day experience, but it becomes an effective recruiting tool. It really sends the message and sets the tone for the organization. And that's actually incredibly meaningful and not too difficult to do. I think there's also a need, just as you would execute against a business strategy, to really set a specific diversity strategy. So what is the business case? What's our explicit metrics by which we're going to judge this, and how are we going to execute it? It starts to take kind of the, as you probably are aware, having looked at this across industries, it takes the abstract and kind of the vague notion that we want to do better and put some numbers behind it and puts a plan against it, just as you would any other business strategy. Going pretty much hand in hand with that is the fourth hidden gem I call out, which is public transparency on diversity. So we really shouldn't limit the knowledge on what these goals are, how we want to promote diversity in the workplace. This should be very public. We should be tracking progress against achieving them. It should be a shared objective within the organization, not just the exclusive kind of pet projects of a select few, or a notion that we should, you know, be doing something but don't want to call ourselves out for fear of looking bad. I think, and what we found in the data, is that this transparency is actually incredibly important to creating momentum and trustworthiness within the workplace. The fifth is around training. So there's a lot of new trainings out there that really focus on how do you get to the culture of inclusion and how do you help identify and mitigate any sort of underlying biases. Again, this goes to the table stake of guaranteeing a bias-free day-to-day experience. It's not that easy to get to or that obvious, and so having these trainings really help bring in the dialogue and get the organization focused on the right objectives to help make that a reality.
Great. Well, that's really interesting and I think gives organizations a lot of helpful direction on where they can help and really makes sense. So what are the remaining three?
So these are three that we've cut out and kind of broken into a separate category because they are still hidden gems. So they're still highly valued by women and potentially undervalued by the broader organization. So they're very worth doing, but they do require a little bit longer to implement. And that's because they usually require more of a formal program against it. So the three that I would call out here, one is flexible work programs. Mm-hmm. These are in place at most companies. You've probably seen them. But they're often not super effective. And they're not super effective for a few reasons. One is sometimes they're just seen as for moms only or for moms with young kids only. And the ones that we've seen are most successful are the ones that are designed around having something that both men and women can take advantage of, independent of seniority level or status of children, and really include different options to enable flexibility. This is a place where I could see aerospace and defense companies really leading, and I know they're already experimenting with things like 980 or working from home, and this could be really something that spurs them and differentiates them from other competitors in the workplace. Just a kind of asterisk on that, 980 is where you work 9 days a week for 80 hours and you get every other Friday off. And a number of companies are using this to attract new folks and to maintain the folks that they have.
Sounds pretty appealing. I bet it works well. Can you tell us a little bit about the others too?
So the second one I'd call out is one that is not new. It's parental leave. And this, perhaps new or not new, is now very much proven through data to have a measurable impact on recruiting and retention. And what we found in our research, in fact, from a BCG perspective, is that women who take parental leave are 93% more likely to stay with the same employer 9 to 12 months after a children's birth than those who take no leave. So mm-hmm. counterintuitive, perhaps, but it actually is a great retention tool and a great way to promote both men and women and diversity in the workplace. And the third is childcare. So another way that companies can really differentiate here is to offer childcare programs such as on-site care or emergency backup care. This is often targeted at women, but can also increasingly help attract younger men and women who want to take childcare responsibilities on, and perhaps a little different than their older counterparts, really truly value this childcare option. So again, as we think about the shortfall, and a lot of these solutions, to your point, aren't necessarily super specific to A&D industries, but the industry itself has a very acute need. They have an aging workforce and a workforce where they're going to face increasing competition. And so these programs both help differentiate them from other aerospace and defense companies, but will hopefully also help attract new, younger generations to the industry overall, which is also a strong need.
Great. Well, thank you so much for all the insight, Lacey. We're nearly out of time. You're obviously all in on this research. Are you willing to share whether you're personally making use of any of the aforementioned formal programs that help increase diversity and how you are promoting diversity, especially in A&D?
I actually would love to. So I returned from maternity leave just 4 months ago, actually. So I took both the parental leave and I also make use of emergency care, child care needs on more than one occasion as things have come up. And I think what I also found important, although my husband's not in the industry, thought it was critical for him to make use of these options as well so that we can start to build a broad use of them in the workplace. I think talking about the importance and benefits of diversity is also important. Like I mentioned before, it's come up a number of times just from the pure fact that there aren't that many women in the industry, and it's a topic of discussion as one of the few women in the industry, even in the BCG aerospace and defense practice. And I think many are super curious about how can we help and what does it need to do. And so I think sharing this research is highly important. I like sharing it in any means we can, from articles to podcasts to videos to whatnot, is very important because I think it helps promote both the dialogue as well as put some of the facts and figures behind what needs to get done. And personally, with my clients, it's been a running dialogue that, you know, we're not doing any work against necessarily, but it's been more to help guide their thinking and really push forward some of the actions that they feel need to take place but weren't quite sure what or how to do them.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, and thank you for being a role model as well. It's been a pleasure to have you here with us today, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure.
If you'd like to find out more about this or any other research on diversity and inclusion, please go to bcg.com/women/publications. Thank you so much for listening, and until next time.